1962, two independent producers, Bill Bunky Shepherd and Carl Davis, brought a song and a singer to Vee Jay. They had a hunch that he'd be a sensation.
As I walk through this world, nothing can stop
I put the song together in a rehearsal. We were just opening up our throats, do 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 do, going up the stairs, and I just told them to say do do. It was really do 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 d o d o, and we began to say do do do.
I said, we got to cut that tomorrow because the session was the next day. And they said, wait, no, we don't have no lyrics for this song. I said, well, go home and write something.
And it was, to me, a strange sounding record. Duke, 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 duke. There's a whole bunch of dukes, you know. But Calvin said, Calvin Carter, in the ear. Calvin said, Ab, that's a smash.
I'll never forget, we released The Duke of Earl November the 5th, 1962. And by Christmas, it was almost the number one record in the country.
The Duke of Earl sold over a million copies and helped make Vee Jay one of the most successful R&B labels in the country. But for Abner, it wasn't enough. He wanted Vee Jay to tap the dollars of the white pop market. To do that, the label would need more than crossover music.
Racism was a fact of life. It existed, and segregation, all that kind of stuff. So what? I mean, I hate it, and it's bad, and it's wrong, and it's immoral, and all that kind of stuff, but I gotta move. We had white guys in the workforce who did promotion in the South. We had Red Schwartz did promotion for us on the East Coast. Whatever it took to get whatever we needed, I'd hire it. I didn't see any reason why Vee Jay shouldn't be what we call a full-line label. Jazz, blues, spiritual, country and western, pop. I thought we could do it, and we set about doing it.
And they did. Vee Jay had one of the biggest hits in jazz history with Eddie Harris's Exodus to Jazz. And in 1962, Abner put Vee Jay on the map in the pop market. Vee Jay launched the Four Seasons.
Big girls, they don't cry.
But the move that assured Vee Jay a place in rock and roll history happened in 1962 when they went to EMI Records in England to pick up the U.S. rights to a British crooner, Frank Ifield.
I remember you.
As part of the deal, EMI threw in a group that was popular in England but virtually unknown in America. Once again, it was a story of one record company picking up a group that another company turned down. EMI first offered the Beatles to its own American subsidiary, Capitol Records.
But if Capitol doesn't want it, then EMI is free to peddle it. So Capitol, for some reason or another, whoever was in charge at that time, said, I don't like this stuff, no. And so I said, okay, let's go for it.
The Beatles were hot in Europe, but their first American single, Please Please Me, didn't even crack the top 100 in the U.S. So after one more disappointing single, in the spring of 63, Vee Jay put their plans for the Beatles along with the rest of the master tapes on the shelf. As the 60s arrived, R&B began to embrace the sounds of the black church and turn away from the blues. It was music we would later call soul. The dawn of soul in Chicago was Vee Jay's For Your Precious Love by The Impressions, featuring lead singer Jerry Butler and a 16-year-old singer and guitarist, Curtis Mayfield.
We loved singing For Your Precious Love. That was one of our better songs, and of course, that's what we used to audition. And we won over with that particular song.
Curtis became the most prolific songwriter of the Chicago soul era. But it was Jerry Butler who wrote the lyrics to For Your Precious Love.
Rolling Stone magazine said that our recording of For Your Precious Love kind of ushered in what people later became to know as soul music. That there was this wonderful marriage of the street and the church, the secular and the spiritual.
Jerry Butler went solo in 1959, and several of his early hits were written and composed with Curtis Mayfield.
He don't love you like God.
With Jerry Butler gone, Curtis took over the Impressions, and with Fred Cash and Sam Gooden, the group blended mellow R&B harmonies and black gospel styles. The result was silky smooth soul.
Say it's all right.
It's all right.
Say it's all right.
It's all right.
It's all right.
Have a good time, 'cause it's all right.
Curtis Mayfield wrote some of the greatest love songs of all time, as far as I'm concerned. My favorite Curtis Mayfield song is Rainbow. God, singing it for 30 years. And I have the same feeling. It drives me into the same world of ecstasy. I'm trying to do something to him out there.
Yeah. Well, there always has been a Chicago sound. I mean, there's so many fantastic artists, whether they be blues, contemporary, or gospel, were recorded out of Chicago.
One of those artists was Major Lance. He danced his way on to the pop charts with Curtis Mayfield's Monkey Time. But it was the producer of the Duke of Earl, Carl Davis, who made Major Lance a star.
He was a boxer. He was a little prize fighter. So he could dance. I mean, he had moves that you wouldn't believe. But Major was not the world's greatest singer. So what we did was we got the Impressions, which was Fred, Sam, and Curtis. And they did the background. And there were, and the spots that Major was weak at, we had the background do the lead with him.
When you look at the guys who were part of the Chicago music scene, Carl Davis as a producer, no recognition whatsoever, but I don't know if there was anybody from that era, 60s and 70s, that could go any deeper in terms of knowledge of record production and instincts.
From the mid-1960s through the early 70s, Carl Davis headed up Brunswick Records and pumped out hits with artists like the Shy Lights. Brunswick was part of a soul music explosion out of the city. Black teenagers danced to music from Chicago companies with names as upbeat as their sounds. Okay, Wonderful, Marvelous, Constellation, Mercury, ABC Paramount, Chess, and Curtain. While these labels and others competed for Black America's attention, a label out of Detroit stepped up to steal the show. Motown Motown reshaped R&B for mainstream America. They made it easy to dance to, added sequins, slick choreography, and captured both white and black audiences. One of their biggest innovations was the way they presented their artists.
Teaching artists how to walk, talk, dress, perform, everything else. That, hence before, I don't think had been done, not to that extent.
Billy Davis was the songwriting partner of Motown president Berry Gordy until Leonard Chess brought him to Chicago in 1961.
Leonard saw Motown rise and prosper, you know, so he wasn't dumb. He realized he had to do something different in order to sell more records.
Davis left the slick pop sound of Detroit behind and went to work with Chicago artists, steeped in gospel and rough edge rhythm and blues. At Chess, he found artists like Sugar Pie DeSanto, Mitty Collier, Minnie Riperton, and me, Etta James.
Yeah. I believe that
I loved Etta because she had this, she was pre-Aretha, a great voice with a great soul, a great heart.
She was such a character. Remember, she'd come with an entourage, a dressmaker, a hairdresser, this, that. And she was definitely in the top echelon of a woman singer. Man, she could sing.
In the Billy Davis era, Chess added pop influences and full-blown arrangements and began to move away from the blues to music aimed at a new black generation.